subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
We talk about 2.5 things today, or maybe 2.25 or a bit, because I will also do some storytelling. Let me warn you, this is about sport, about Olympic sports. The two things we talk about, one is a deadly boring politics, but what to do? Politics is our roti, dal, chawal, dahi, chawal, tahir sadam, whatever you want to call it. That is it. That's our staple. We live politics at the print. So we'll talk politics, but second, we'll also talk about Olympic sport. Not so much about what's happening in these Olympics, but a little bit about Olympic sport and some very interesting and fascinating facts involving great Indian athletes at the Olympics, at that level, because real sport is Olympics. And even at the Olympics, the mother and the father of all sports is athletics. It's track and field. Anyway, first of all, politics, such as it is. Everybody knows that Yediyurappa is now gone. He was like a number 11 batsman who continues batting through a few overs. Then comes a rain break. Then he comes back. Then the day's game ends. Then he comes the next morning. So at some point, he has to go. So that's how Yediyurappa was for the past several months. He's now gone. In fact, earlier, we had seen that he was on his way out when Narendra Modi, on his visit to Karnataka, had gone to the big Lingayat Mutt to address the Lingayat seers, because therein lay a message that Yediyurappa, his vote bank is the Lingayats, and he works through the clergy. You saw him lining up these Lingayat clergy over the past week or 10 days, basically in solidarity with him, because his threat was that if you treat me badly, then the Lingayat vote will go away from you. And he has shown that power in the past to the BJP. We recorded a full Cut the Clutter on this last week, so I will not repeat it. But now it looks like he's been assuaged a bit. He's been told it's time to go. You're 78, going on 79, not getting any younger. You're not looking very and sounding very fit. And most likely there will be a lollipop for his son. So that dynasty will carry on. But what does it tell us? So I tweeted today, and you can see that tweet, that now BJP has also completed its process of becoming a high command run party like the Congress party. As I said that, in fact, DK Singh, our political editor, pointed out to me that while you have tweeted this, please tell me which political party in India right now is not a high command run party. So with his help, we went over all the political parties, and you know what? It's a straight line. There are no exceptions. So I will just run through this list very quickly. Just in last week or 10 days, we've seen the Congress party put Amrinder Singh in his place. Amrinder Singh was the only regional leader in the Congress party who had stature of his own, who had won elections on his own, and who thought he could still win elections on his own, and he could also have his say with the party in his state. He's been cut to size. So you saw the new high command in the Congress party emerge with Rahul and Priyanka. Similarly, now the BJP, once again with Yediyurappa, they've completed a process of actually downsizing all their major state leaders. So before Yediyurappa, there was Raman Singh. He lost his election. He was made vice president. But what's he doing so far? We don't know. He's completely in the shade. Vasundhara Raje, you can see that there isn't that much love lost between the BJP and her, but she was the BJP's preeminent leader in Rajasthan. Now there is none. So BJP's calculation would again be that maybe they can win an election on Narendra Modi's name and appoint somebody as chief minister. So it's very much like a Congress mindset. Similarly, even Shivraj Singh Chauhan, he's back in Madhya Pradesh, but he's been downsized. He's nowhere near of the power that he had in the past. So that is the BJP. But look at some others. Look at KCR, K. Chandrasekhar Rao, and his party TRS. It's purely a family run party. In fact, it's a high command run party, and the high command is nothing but the family. So he threw out his health minister, Itala Rajendra, just like that. In fact, Itala Rajendra, in the middle of the pandemic, he said that I believe the chief minister has fired me, which means that chief minister did not even call him to tell him that he was being fired, and that is seen as a big insult. I remember I did once ask Ramvilas Paswan on a Walk the Talk interview that why did you leave BJP while Vajpayee was there? He said, look, he removed me from telecom ministry, which is okay. He is the prime minister. He could have removed me, but he didn't tell me. I saw it on TV. So, hum jaake unse bole ki hum aapki party ke nahi hai. Hum aapki party ke hote to aap hume jaise marzi hata sakte hai. Lekin hum coalition partner hai. Humko aap TV par nahi hata sakte. Now, even then there was an acceptance that if you are from the same party can treat you the way it wants. So, Itala Rajender, KCR did that, and KCR sometimes is available, sometimes he is not available, sometimes he is accessible to his minister, sometimes he is not. This is a one-man party, but of course, there is a son and daughter who are also quite powerful and do their own stuff, but it's a fully high command run party. The allegation against Itala Rajendra was that his family run hatchery, poultry farm, had encroached upon about 100 acres of land belonging to SCs, STs and OBCs. By the way, Rajendra just after that has joined the BJP and he is now BJP's senior leader in that state. So, BJP has been out talent hunting and KCR made that talent such as it is available to the BJP. Then you see Jagan, YSRCP, next door to Telangana. Again, a major powerful state in Andhra Pradesh, contributes a large number of MPs to national parliament. YSRCP MP, the party's own MP from Narsapur, he's been, Raju, he's been arrested by the state CID. He's been arrested. They filed a case of sedition against him, among many things. In fact, the state government has now even gone to the Supreme Court stressing that he should be charged under sedition because he tried to bring down the state government. What did Mr. Raju do? He actually went to the Supreme Court seeking the cancellation of Jagan's bail. Jagan, as you know, is on bail in those earlier corruption cases, Prevention of Corruption Act cases, and he's chief minister. So, his own party's MP went to Supreme Court seeking the cancellation of bail. So, you can say that there was provocation, but the manner in which it was done, he could have been just fired from the party, but that wasn't done. There was a police case filed, and police case besides other things also, besides hate speech, etc., but also of sedition. So, that tells you the power of, again, one man parties or one man or one woman parties, because they are all not all men as we go through the list. Naveen Patnaik in Odisha. Do you know of any other minister in Odisha? In fact, do you know the names of any other minister in all their cabinets? Unless they have ministers from their own families, their sons, daughters, sons-in-law, daughters-in-law, you don't know anybody. Naveen Patnaik doesn't even have that. He doesn't have any family. He doesn't have a child. One man party, one man government functions like that. He functions with his civil servants and his people seem to like it. So, he keeps on getting re-elected all the time. In fact, we get data from an Indian Express story, which I'll share with you, that shows that by 2017, in 17 years of being in power, he had already fired 44 ministers. Who are those 44? I won't even know, and I don't. And it will take some counting now to figure out how many he might have fired after that. So, this is again the power of one man, power of the high command. High command led by either one man or a woman or by a family or a dynasty. Then you might have said that Nitish Kumar does not have an heir, does not have a dynasty, and he used to be quite accessible, quite approachable, very open. But see, in this avatar, in this innings, he's completely gone incommunicado. He's rarely available even to his ministers. In fact, he now does not speak, does not give interviews. He does his own stuff in Bihar. Assembly last March witnessed a spectacle that normally you would not have expected from a Nitish Kumar government. That was, the police was called into the house and more than a dozen of opposition MLAs were thrown out. Why? Because they were protesting against Nitish Kumar government's decision to convert 18 battalions of Bihar military police, which is like the state armed police, it's just called military police. They were going to convert them into a special armed force with total powers of arresting, raiding, entering any premises, etc., etc. And there was a protest against that. He's cracked down like this, very un-Nitish like. So, Nitish Kumar again, his party, he runs the party, he's the boss. nobody else matters. Once again, the same straight line, high command. Mamata Banerjee, total control. In fact, we marvel at the BJP's ability to keep secrets that nobody knew until Yogi Adityanath's name was announced that he was going to be Chief Minister of UP. And BJP surprises us with its appointments all the time. In fact, they take great delight in proving the media and the pundits wrong. And they are always right. Look what she's done. All of the media was speculating that her one Rajya Sabha seat that was available to her party could go to Mukul Roy, could go to Yashwant Sinha. Mukul Roy had gone to the BJP and come back. He's a senior leader from Bengal. Yashwant Sinha is a senior leader nationally. He would be a good presence in Rajya Sabha. He'll be a good voice there. But no, she didn't give it to any of those. She gave it to former Prasad Bharati chief Jawahar Sarkar, a former IAS officer. Nobody could have speculated. Why? Because she, once you are the boss, once the high command runs a party and once a person is the high command, then that person can keep everything in her mind. Nobody has to know because nothing has to be discussed in the open at a working committee, at a parliamentary party, at nothing. So that is the pattern right now that you see everywhere. See Arvind Kejriwal. Arvind Kejriwal, no one else matters in his party, and those in his party who thought that they were building a new kind of party with a lot of inner democracy, those people are now out. And one after the other, those wickets have fallen. So you know that this is Arvind Kejriwal's party. So the same pattern goes on. In fact, I've already counted 9 for you. And I will now tell you the 10th also. The 10th is Pinarayi Vijayan. Now, I would have said in some Kathak Letter episodes in the past that the only political party in India which still has some internal democracy left is the CPM. Because they have voting in their Politburo, Central Committee, they have debates. They also have a tradition of debating, right? Ideological issues, complex issues, partnerships. To join this coalition or not, should Jyoti Basu become Prime Minister or not? Jyoti Basu wanted to, but he was voted out within his own party. So CPM is a party which, for good reasons or bad reasons, I don't think that worked very well for them. I don't think walking out of UPA 1 over the nuclear deal worked very well for them or their so-called secular commitment. But when once they decide by majority that something has to be done, they've done that. See what's happened now. Now that party is reduced to one state. That is Kerala. Kerala now has its own high command and its own leader of that high command keeps total control over everything. That is Pinarayi Vijayan. So much so that Pinarayi Vijayan got the party to say that none of the ministers in his outgoing cabinet will become ministers again. This even included Shailja, who had acquired such a larger than life status all over the world because of her early handling of the pandemic. She was out. He said nobody who's been a minister will be minister again. They all got out. He also got 22 sitting MLAs out to keep out of the election, including 5 ministers. Why? Because he got his party to say that anybody who's had 2 terms already will not get another seat. Who's had 2 consecutive terms already will not have another seat. So the last party which had some degree of internal democracy, also in the one state that it matters, doesn't have it anymore. It has its own high command and its own supremo, its own leader. And then you see all the other parties who may not have much power right now. Mayawati's party, high command, just Mayawati. Samajwadi party, high command, just Akhilesh Yadav and his immediate family. Maybe his father to some extent, but Akhilesh Yadav. NCP, Sharad Pawar and family. Shiv Sena, the Thakres, no one else matters. And all these are parties following the same pattern. So right now in Indian politics, there are no exceptions. In fact, I can go on and on. I can tell you about DMK. You know how DMK runs. It's Stalin's wish. Everything Stalin wants gets done. So this is the way India's politics has now gone. Now, having talked about politics, let me talk about a little sport. Now, something very interesting happened this morning. You know the term serendipity, which I use quite often. Serendipity is when you discover something, sort of fortunately something nice and pleasant. So my phone rang this morning and I saw it said Gurbachan Singh Randhawa. So I picked up the phone. It so happened that last Friday he had called me a couple of times and I did not take the call because Fridays get a little frantic for me because I'm also writing national interest, etc., etc. So I thought I'll call him later, and I forgot over the weekend. So he called me in the morning, and first thing he said to me in Punjabi was, yeah, I was worried about you because you didn't pick up your phone a couple of times. So I was hoping that you are all right, because, you know, after the second wave, if an old friend does not pick up the phone, you worry whether they are alive or not, or they were caught by the second wave. So I said, nahi ji, main theek thaak hega, koi gal nahi. Now, Gurbachan Singh Randhawa, now in, well into his 80s, there is a debate in India, which unfortunately has not found the fuel it should have. Who is the greatest athlete as in track and field, that India has produced? So Milkha Singh acquired his star quality. Milkha Singh recently passed away. Gurbachan Singh Randhawa is Milkha Singh's vintage. You will see his pictures. In fact, when the movie on Milkha Singh, the biopic was coming out, Bhag Milkha Bhag, after that he had got in touch with me, and somebody had mentioned his name to me, and I had reached out to him and recorded a Walk the Talk with him. I will share that link with you, and also a picture from that episode of Walk the Talk. Now, Gurbachan Singh Randhawa in the 60s should have been the biggest star of Indian track and field, of Indian Olympic sports. Milkha Singh's, his highest achievement was finishing fourth at Rome in 400 meters. Gurbachan Singh Randhawa finished fifth in very tough event, 110 meters hurdles at Tokyo, fifth with a timing of 14 seconds for the first time in Asia. In 1960, National Games, the same year when Milkha was also riding the peak of his fame, Gurbachan Singh Randhawa set four national records in the National Games. Four. Which four were these? High jump, 110 meter hurdles, that's his favorite event, javelin throw, and decathlon. Now, what is decathlon? Decathlon is the toughest challenge for an athlete. I'm holding forth a little bit because all of us are cricket experts, but we know very little about the parent of all sports, that is track and field athletics. Now, decathlon is an event where athletes compete over 10 events over 2 days. So day one, 5 events, 100 meters sprint, long jump, short put, high jump, and 400 meters, right? So all these 5 happen in 1 day. And each time as you finish one event, you are given points depending on your performance. One who gets the highest points ultimately wins. So he set the national decathlon record also, besides 110 meter hurdles, high jump, and javelin in 1960 National Games. Then on day 2 in decathlon, you have 110 meter hurdles, discus throw. Discus throw is, pole vault, javelin throw, and 1500 meters. So this is a grueling competition over 2 days, 10 events. He set a national record there. 1964, as I told you, finished fifth at Tokyo Olympics. That year, of the 9 races in which he competed in Western Europe, he won 8. Now, maybe with slightly better facilities, training, etc., etc., coaching, he could have also hit the medals tally. But for some reason, he did not get there. 1962 Jakarta, at the Asian Games though, he won 2 gold medals, his favorite event, that is 110, and also decathlon there. Now, the reason he called me this morning was a simple one. He just called me to say, okay, dekho ji, somebody, a Punjabi journalist, is writing a biography on me in Punjabi. So if you would write a blurb for this, like an endorsement, to see English which likhte ho, main Punjabi kar langa. So I told him my Punjabi is not that bad, so I will send him one in Punjabi. One of the greatest athletes lives in Delhi. Please read up about him. You will learn more about him. And also, while I'm talking about Gurbachan Singh Randhawa and his favorite 110 meter hurdles, a little question about hurdles. Do you know how many hurdles are there in a race? What is the distance between them? And is the height of all hurdles the same or different one? In fact, when you read stories from the Olympics now, you might read somewhere that so and so won the event in high hurdles. So it's, one is high hurdles, what is the other one? So here is a little athletic intricacy. Intricacy is that 110 meter hurdles has what might be called high hurdles. This is 3.5 feet. 1.067 meters, because everything is now metric. So 3.5 feet or exactly 42 inches. So that is the height. 400 meter hurdles, on the other hand, has 3 feet. So those are a bit lower. For women, it's 2.5 there. So 400 is lower, 3 feet. 110 is higher. You have to jump higher. That is 3.5 feet. In 110 meters, you have 10 hurdles. First hurdle comes after 45 feet and then each hurdle comes after 30 feet. Because remember, these things were all designed before the metric system came in. Also from the same period, this was the golden age of Indian track and field in the 60s. Also, because we don't remember anybody who did not come close to a medal at the big Olympics. Pan Singh Tomar, our steeplechaser, he was also a product of the 60s. He later, unfortunately, became a dacoit. There was a biopic made on him where Irfan Khan played his character quite beautifully and quite touchingly. That is the story of his real life. Once again, Pan Singh Tomar had a tough event. His event was steeplechase. Steeplechase is something that's taken from horse racing. Steeplechase has a large number of obstacles. In fact, it has 28 barriers in 3000 meters. So you run 3 kilometers with 28 barriers, of which 7 are water jumps, the rest are hurdles. So it's quite a grueling event also. Once again, he's somebody we don't remember for his athletics. In fact, when I tried to Google Pan Singh Tomar, I got to the movie. And funnily, when I googled decathlon, it took me to the athletics goods store. And I even said decathlon athletic event, it still took me to the athletics goods store called decathlon. So that shows you how little do we look at Olympic sports in India. While of course, we want gold medals all the time when our athletes go out. Now, look at the gap between us and the world. If you look at 100 meters men, 100 meters men, the world record right now is 9.58 seconds. 9.58 seconds. I don't know. Maybe someday somebody will run 100 meters in no time, right? 9.58 seconds. It's taken me that long telling you this. The Indian national 100 meters record is 10.26 seconds for men. So that is the difference between us and the rest of the world. For women, Indian record, by the way, is held by Ameya Kumar Malik, so I must mention that. For women, for India, it's Jyoti Chand at 11.17. For the world, it is 10.49, but it's an old record. It was set up in 1988 at Indianapolis at a big meet by the famous, by the supremely famous Florence Griffith Joyner, or Flojo as she was called. So there is a big gap between Indian performances and global standards right now. And for us to get to the medal situation, either we need a prodigy like Mirabai Chanu, who comes in from nowhere, or say Abhinav Bindra, or we need to work very hard and invest a lot over a long period of time. And I told you that I will tell you a story. So here is the story. I have covered one Olympics and one full Asian Games in my life. So one Olympics 1988 Seoul, and then the Asian Games in 1990 in Beijing, fully for India Today magazine, in the strength of one plus one photographer in each one. Now Seoul 1988 is when the famous Ben Johnson Carl Lewis race took place. I am sure that rings a bell with all of you. And that is when Ben Johnson won the race in a record timing of 9.79 seconds. And it was a remarkable race because top four runners in that race all finished in less than 10 seconds. It was like a boom, like a train was coming at you, an express train or a bullet train. And even there, a race run at that pace, you could see Ben Johnson with his big muscles running ahead of everybody. I almost got the feeling, I hope I'm not in his way, because there was so much momentum and he was so much muscle and so much power. And it became a famous victory. Now, I will tell you the story of what unfolded after that. What unfolded after that was that we had very little to do in Seoul. India was doing very badly. It was a medalless Olympics. In fact, it's very depressing sometimes to be an Indian journalist at these games. So we were hanging out late night at the media center in the Olympic Village, because we're staying in the Olympic Village. What do you do at night? You walk around. Most of us are insomniacs. So I, along with Lokesh Sharma, who was a fellow sports journalist, he used to work for the Telegraph then, we sauntered into the media center just to play some games with the computers. The Koreans had an app even in 1988 on their computers, and that app actually, it was a game. It could predict various athletes' biorhythms. I don't know where they got it from. So when you had nothing else to do, you checked out what will be so-and-so's biorhythm on such and such day. So you're just wasting our time. As we were sitting there, suddenly I found Lokesh Sharma coming at me, very excited. And he said, Oi, tere ko pata hai kya hua? I said, kya hua? He said, Ben Johnson ka susu. I said, kya ho gaya? Ben Johnson ka susu kya bol raha hai? And he was breathless. He said, Ben Johnson ka susu fail ho gaya. So I said, how do you know? So he had overheard two lab technicians talking, generally around that area, and gossiping in the Olympic Village, saying that Ben Johnson's second sample had failed and he had tested positive for a substance called stanzolol. Stanzolol is an anabolic steroid. Now what happened? We had the biggest scoop of our lives in our hand, but we could do nothing with it. I worked for a fortnightly. It was 5:30 in the morning in Seoul, so it was late into the night. In any case, my fortnightly could have done nothing with it. Even Lokesh Sharma's paper, it had printed already. There was nothing he could have done. No newspapers had websites those days, no Twitter, no Facebook. So we could not boast about the fact that we had the greatest sporting scoop in the world to anybody. Lokesh Sharma, by the way, was cleverer. So he sold that story immediately to AFP. And that's where I could see that he'll become an entrepreneur, and he became a sports entrepreneur. He runs a very successful sports entrepreneurship business. So in my book, I call him India's first Jerry Maguire. I wrote about this in a National Interest in 2013. In fact, the same National Interest where I talked about Gurbachan Singh Randhawa, and I'm sharing all of it with you today as a link. The reason I'm bringing this story to you is because news just came that the Chinese gold medal winner in Mirabai Chanu's event is being retested by the anti-doping agency because looks like there is some suspicion of doping there. And while I have you captive, I will also tell you a delightful, real-life athletic story about the hurdles. So Ashwini Nachappa, one of our finest sprinters of all times, I hope she's listening in Bengaluru. He was once put under some pressure by the Athletic Federation, was getting an unfair deal. And who headed the Athletic Federation then in India? But Suresh Kalmadi. So Ashwini Nachappa, being Ashwini Nachappa and with a true athlete's attitude, said that if Suresh Kalmadi can tell the distance between two hurdles, I will stop running.